saluting the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Okay, everyone, thank you for attending. The mayor is not here because he is on official city business. He's at a mayor's conference, so I will be filling in. Madam Superintendent, did you want to do a moment of silence?
I do. Just this past week, we had a teacher, Leslie Paul. Some of you might have known Mrs. Paul. She was a teacher in the Brockton Public Schools for 42 years. And even in her retirement, she came back and worked extended day. I worked with her in many of the summer programs that we had when we had the academic support money. Always engaging with the children, very positive. If you looked at the write-up in her obituary, she clearly talks about how proud she was to have been a Brockton teacher. I did go to the services, spoke with her two sons and her husband, and made sure that we thanked her for all her years of service. So I would ask for a moment of silence there. And also, I want to bring up something that I know becomes something that we seem to look at almost every night when we open up the paper. And if it's not Brockton, it's some other place. And it doesn't just mean cities. This happens all over. And we recently had the loss of life of a mom of two of our students in the Brockton Public Schools, 30-year-old woman, senseless. And I want to not only have a moment of silence for the mom and certainly for her children, our prayers are with them, but what I want to say is I want to thank our principals, because when this happened right away, there were phone calls from the principals. They jumped into action, made sure that they were able to meet with the teachers of these two students at the Arnone, and the other having just recently left the Arnone, going to the Plouffe. The principals with a team were able to go to the home, make sure they offered support. Deputy Superintendent Thomas jumped in and made sure that we were able to support the children if they were going to be living with other relatives, to make sure they could remain at their homes. And it just, again, is why we are the school district that we are. So I want to thank everybody. We will continue to support these youngsters. And unfortunately, we're seeing this happen much too often. So a moment of silence.
Please. Thank you, everyone. The next item on the agenda is the hearing of visitors. Do we have anyone signed up for this evening? Okay. We will move on to the third item, which is the consent agenda. The consent agenda is the bundling of routine matters and business to be voted on by the committee. This is the opportunity for anyone on the committee to remove a particular item for further discussion. Seeing the consent agenda for this evening, is there anyone on the committee that would like to remove a particular item? Mr. Sullivan.
Item G.
Did you say G?
G.
G. Okay, we will remove item G. Anyone else? Okay. Can I then have a motion from someone from the floor to approve all items with the exception of item G? Seconded by Ms. Plant. Thank you. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? Okay, great. Mr. Sullivan, you are up with item G.
Normally it's Utah that brings all us these donations up. And I thought it was a large, real large donation. I thought we should talk about it a little bit.
Very good.
I don't know whether you wanted to or the superintendent, because it just seems like a real large donation.
Well, you know what we do have here tonight? We do have our grant writer here. I know we spoke about this at another meeting. I'm happy to talk about it, but we are going to be having a presentation by Karen Watts, who worked on this grant, and she'll be able to give you additional information on it if we can wait till she gives her presentation.
Okay, I just wanted to mention that it's 500 smartphones or 500
smartphones tablets. And tablets,
yep. Which it's got to be a big expense.
This grant, and I can't remember the exact number, 11, I think, throughout the country were given. We were one of the selected cities, and you know right now our initiative is to push into the schools one-to-one devices, making sure kids have internet access, especially with high-stakes testing that is coming. So we were very pleased when Brockton High was selected. And again, you're talking, I believe it's over a four-year period, five-year period, these devices will be in our schools and will be eligible to receive new devices at different times to replace the devices that we have. We're working right now on making sure that we have policies and procedures in place for, you know, how the students will utilize these. But this will make a difference for our students.
It'll make a big difference. And there's one more part in there, about the free internet for the next
four
years.
Yes, internet access, correct.
Which is a big deal for a lot of people.
And the internet access is the four-year, yeah.
It's very fortuitous that we have Ms. Karen Watkins-Watts here to discuss this. So this is something, Mr. Sullivan, that I'm glad you mentioned. And we have the expert with us tonight that will go into more detail. So
normally, if you were there, you would have mentioned it.
Oh, well, I can always count on you, Mr. Sullivan. So
I make a motion to approve item G.
Okay, second by someone? Okay, Mrs. Sullivan. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? Okay, Madam Superintendent, I believe we are moving on to communication.
I want to start the evening by doing our student report, Somto.
Good evening. How are you?
Good evening.
We have to get her hooked up, mic'd up.
There you go.
National History Day is tomorrow. Students will display their projects in the Azure Cafeteria. Individual and group winners will move on to the state competition. There was access testing today for nearly 900 English language learner students. Second semester starts on January 27th. Final exams for semester courses will be held on the 23rd through the 25th. Term 2 report cards will be available February 3rd. Science Fair is February 2nd from 8 to 10:30 a.m. And 8th grade parent orientation is February 8th at 6 p.m.
Very good. And I'm glad you brought that up. I think it's really important as we talk to parents out there. When you listen to Somto talk about all of the things happening, certainly academically, at our high school. You know, National History Day is phenomenal. If you haven't had an opportunity to visit the schools and to see the work of the students, it isn't just like the poster boards. I think back when many of us, or certainly I'm speaking for myself, were in high school, come and see the living history, you know, certainly all of the things that our students do with research and their presentations. Many times they go on to not just the state, but the national level. It's fascinating to see. When you talk about the access testing, this is going on throughout the district. 900 students at Brockton High School. And this is a continual flow of testing for us. In any other place, it would be disruptive. At Brockton High, we somehow make it work for our students. You know, science fair, same thing. And I think most importantly, Somto, the one thing that you talked about is when you're talking about being a student at Brockton High School, Brockton High School is an excellent choice for so many youngsters. So when eighth graders are making that decision, and again, you look at our award-winning bands and chorus, and you look at the academics and our IB program, our advanced placement classes, you know, all of the things that we offer, our award-winning athletics, I think every one of us could go on and on about the opportunities that present themselves here at your high school. So I would hope that parents out there that are looking for options for high school, Brockton High is an excellent choice. So thank you. And I think you must all be really pleased that the testing for our students, what were the dates, the 23rd through the 25th? So that's before sports becomes crazy if, in fact, your Patriots go on. So I think the timing is just perfect, as long as we have a snowstorm, Mr. Minicello, on that Sunday night.
Well, first of all, you said if. When?
When they go on.
My goodness, Madam Superintendent. So. Yes, we will wear out this weather and we will endure, but the Patriots will be moving on, I can tell you that.
Okay, then I'm ready. So those of you that aren't following the story, Mr. Minicello's favorite winter, the winter of 2015, if you recall, we had a storm on a Monday night that, you know, we thought that was the storm of all storms. And that Sunday night, and the Patriots, of course, were in the Super Bowl against Seattle, right?
It was a great day to stay home.
And we had to call school off that night, knowing, and you know what happened with that second storm that came. So you told me that was just
that
perfect
was the
timing.
Best, the perfect timing, the perfect storm.
So those weather people, take a look and see if the stars are aligning. Okay, let me move on to the charter school update. There really has been no change at this point in enrollment, students going back and forth. There is no change. I also want to mention a couple of things about our human resource office and our diversity meetings that are taking place. Again, we had a meeting, and I think it's our fourth meeting. The fifth one is scheduled for early February. We have an excellent, and this is the Brockton Public Schools Diversity Task Force. They will be presenting to you. I know they're going to be finalizing their action plan. And as I told you at the last meeting, it's an action plan that is doable. And it's an action plan for this year. We have a number of community members. We're still bringing on a couple of additional members, but we probably have about 10 to 12 members, and we'll be dividing into subgroups to make sure that we can continue to report to you on the things that are happening with looking at the diversity of our teaching staff or our staff in general in the Brockton Public Schools. I also want to talk about a number of visits I have recently made. And one of the things happening at the Arnone School and at the Baker School is something called a monitor site visit. And this is something that we qualified as a district for some grant funding. That money is being used at two schools. And if you remember back, and this was Boston was at the forefront of this, one of the things that they were talking to the governor about in the state was not waiting to become a level 4 or 5 school, but to take a look at money being infused into a district or support, looking at best practices to make sure that you did not have a level 4 or level 5 school, which means really intervention and involvement from the state level from DESE. So we have two schools that we've been watching, you know, very carefully. One is the Arnone, the other is the Baker. We have decided to go forward with monitor site visits, and what they do is a company comes in and they survey, they speak to teachers, the principal provides information. There are phone calls with district leadership that myself, the Deputy Superintendent Barry, and Executive Director June Saber McGuire had today with DESE. I know our principal right now at the Arnone has had conversation with this group coming in, and I want you to know, if you're hearing about it, that they look at a number of areas. And the areas are leadership, shared responsibility, and professional collaboration. They look at intentional practices for improving instruction. They look at student-specific supports and instruction for all students. And they look at the school, culture, and climate. When they are finished coming in and speaking, and it's very random, it's very research-based, when they come in, there will be a report when they finish. So the Arnone probably will finish towards the end of the month of January. Within about a month, they will give us a full report, and they'll talk about, and again, this is for our district to make decisions, but they talk about looking at those structures, talk about some of these intentional practices, where we are, where we need to be, and it really will help us as we look to, you know, support, you know, these two particular schools, but certainly all our schools. One of the things I said today, when they talked to us about things that we do know, one of the things you've seen at two of your schools, and you've seen it at the Huntington, which has gone through this kind of a process, and you saw it most recently at the Raymond School, which was also in the same situation. Those schools happen to qualify and opt for extended learning time, and looked at the practices that I just shared with you, and right away you've seen some real so-called turnaround practices. I have faith that we can continue to do this in our school. I talked very openly about limited budget, and it isn't just about one or two schools. You know, we're looking at continuing to support all our schools. When you talk about supporting students, and you read that line about every student, you're talking about special education students. You're talking about large numbers of English language learners when you're in an urban setting. So I look forward to that report, and I look forward to sharing it with you and seeing where we go. Our goal is to remain the only urban district without a level 4 or 5 school. Any questions on that? I also want to mention in my school visits this past week, I happened to be at the Asheville School for just a regular school visit. And what was happening was the ESPRIT screening that is going on. So for seventh graders throughout the state, we're going through a screening process, which is very new to us. It comes from the Department of Public Health, who actually provides training. It is a universal health screening. It's evidence-based, it's proactive and not reactive, and it's primarily based on prevention. It's not targeted, it's not a targeted screening, meaning every one of the students goes through this process of questions being asked. It is not drug testing, it is not a treatment program, and again, it has to be training that is approved by the Department of Public Health. But what I did see happen, I happened to be at the Asheville, where all of your seventh grade, it was almost like the eyes and ears testing. You know, the seventh graders were all lined up. There were adjustment counselors and nurses that were retired personnel from our Brockton Public Schools. And I thought that was important, that the kids had somebody neutral, somebody that they didn't know, but somebody that was well-trained, understands referral process, if somebody shared something. But it really is, again, to be proactive and make sure that we're supporting our students so they're making healthy choices, and if there are any concerns, that we refer them to the proper authorities. I believe, Dr. Murray, you told me that the Asheville is completed, the Davis is completed, and they're the only two completed at this point. So this will happen, and you might hear of it in all of your schools. As I said, the process was seamless. I know Dr. Taurasi and his staff has been working on that. But I also want to thank those retired people that are able to come back and support us in a way that certainly makes sense. And before I go on, I want to also mention just a couple of things before I invite Karen Watts to come up here. We talked about the planetarium dedication. We are working with Jonathan Shapiro, who has been tirelessly trying to get a list of people retired. He's connecting with people. I mean, remember, Brockton High has been open over 45 years. So when you think back on former science teachers and people that truly were part and parcel of the planetarium, if there are any people that you think should be invited, he is planning an evening. I think it's a Friday evening. There's going to be activities for families, for kids, for former colleagues, teachers, administrators. Please get in touch with us if anyone would like to attend this, I don't want to call it a dedication, we've had that, but also to invite them back to see the planetarium, the rebirth of the planetarium. People are very excited. I also want to mention, and you're going to get again a presentation by Karen, but in our alumni or development office, and you'll hear Karen mention those dollars, which are very important, we are working with the alumni office at Brockton High School to bring on somebody very, very part-time, we'll stay under that 19.5 hours, to start to do a cleanup of all our databases. Along with the Alumni Association, we just purchased a program that'll allow us to make sure, and a number of you are alumni of Brockton High School, there'll be outreach to you, we'll clean up those databases so we know that you moved probably from your parents' home to someplace else at this point, so we will be able to reach you. So it's important for us to really get the ball kind of rolling in this area, and I'm very pleased that we're seeing that happen. And I also want to mention Aldo Petronio and I are going to Framingham tomorrow night to begin listening to the state talk about the direct certification. And I changed an appointment to make sure I could be there with him. This is the start of those conversations that truly do have an impact on our budget, and we'll be able to share that with you when we come back. I also want to thank the NAACP for their breakfast at Massasoit Conference Center this past Saturday. Mr. Sullivan, thank you for being there with me and representing our school department. I thought it was excellent. They did a great job. I want to congratulate Steve Bernard, who was honored as now the past president for many years of the NAACP. And I believe Mr. William Brewer is the new president coming on board. I spoke to him, and I look forward to continuing the work that we do. It was very nice. Our students were highlighted. It was an excellent, and I know there were ceremonies going on throughout the Brockton area to honor Dr. Martin Luther King. It's interesting because somebody told me, and if you haven't seen this, you know, when we talk about people that have really made a difference, you know, obviously Dr. King has a holiday named, but you have a movie out there right now, and I think it's called Hidden Figures, and it's really worth it. Not only is it worth it to go and see when you talk about mathematicians, and I love it that it's about women, but, you know, make sure that you get out there, take the kids. It is just a wonderful thing that really honors, you know, some of the work that certainly went on, and for many years they did not get the recognition that they deserve, so I'm really pleased that that recognition is there for them now. And lastly, I want to mention that one of the publications that we get every week is called the Marshall Memo. And it talks about, you know, best practices happening. It talks about policies happening in the field of education. It talks about research. It talks about many, many things. And our administrators, our teachers, look forward to Kim Marshall or the Marshall Memo. And Kim Marshall is a gentleman, by the way. And one of the things in a memo dated January 9th, 2017, and I'll make sure, I can't remember if I put it in your packets, but I'll make sure you have it. And it's Mike Schmoker on three focus areas. And he talks about consistent school-wide implementation of a coherent, content-rich curriculum. It talks about mastery by every teacher of the components of effective and explicit instruction. And it talks about an intensive curriculum-wide emphasis on fairly traditional literacy. And who they mention in here, it says only a fraction of schools are implementing these practices. But those that are, like Brockton High School in Massachusetts, are making dramatic gains. The common factor in Brockton and other successful schools is a leadership team working with colleagues in a way that is highly focused and relentless and provides plenty of opportunity for review and practice to the greatest extent possible. So I thought that was interesting that, again, in a publication that is highly recognized and appreciated by certainly education, they mention, again, Brockton High School. So another feather in Brockton High's cap, and thank you for that.
Questions or comments with regard to anything that was said? Mr. DeAgostino.
Quick request, backtracking slightly. I thought of it after you had moved on. The monitor site visits for Baker and Arnone, I'm sure you're probably planning to do this anyway, but could we get, once you have the report, either some kind of a summary or the report itself just for our own review?
Absolutely. We will have the report. We'll be able to take a look at it and certainly work and make some decisions as to what makes sense for us to support as I said, you know, it isn't just about the Arnone and the Baker. What we'll take away from that report is obviously specific for those schools. But we'll also take a look at some of the best practices that they're talking about employing or some of the concerns that we have. And hopefully we will be able to, you know, with our school and our leadership team, you know, put together a plan to address any concerns.
Great.
Or to start to take a look at moving those schools forward so there is no concern and actually move on from level three and hopefully become a level two or level one school.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Okay, are we inviting?
I'd like to invite Karen Watts down here to give us an update. There's been a lot of concern. She's got excellent information. I've been trying to find a time to really fit it in. I think as we start to talk about our budget, we'll be having that very quickly, our overview of where we're at. I thought it's important to see where grants, which are entitlement grants, competitive grants. Karen will talk about foundation. As Mr. Sullivan brought up, the SPRINT grant, Karen was instrumental in that, and she'll be able to answer any questions that you have.
Okay. Give you a chance to come around. Oh, that'd be great. Thank you. Thank you, right? Good evening, and thank you for the opportunity to give you an update today on the grants office. I'm happy to have celebrated my 10th year with the district as our grant writer, and I report to Aldo Petronio. He's our chief fiscal officer, and so we'll just okay. And today, this evening, I'd like to talk about what grant resources, office resources, and web tools that we have available to our district, our mission and goals, our resource development, what the resource development process looks like, give you a competitive grant awards update and entitlement as well. There'll be a chart there by funding source that you'll see in a moment. And we're going to talk about our office's objectives and then a forecast for our fiscal year 17.
I don't want to apologize.
I'm getting over a cold, so I just cough, so please forgive me in advance. So our grants office is in the Crosby Administration Building. So we have our physical grant office, and we also have a virtual grant office on the school district website. And I believe that was recently updated, where there are technical assistance forms and information for teachers and administrators across the district to take advantage of those. And of course, we're always available to speak with anyone that has a need for technical assistance in terms of management of their grant after the grant award, which is, you know, a very important process, as well as helping with research and identifying funding sources for teaching and learning. So our mission is to procure federal, state, and private grant sources to support teaching and learning so that we can provide a quality education for our students so they are prepared for college and career. And a very important part of that work, of course, is ensuring that our grant proposals align with district policies and procedures, and of course, approval by the school committee as they're presented to you. And then, of course, aligning those grant resources as the proposals are developed with the district strategic plan and school improvement plans. And in our grants office at 2043 Crescent Street, we have a central file repository for all our Brockton grants, and we work very hard to ensure that there are audit-ready files and they're conducive to what our funders are looking for in terms of continuous report, you know, continual quality improvement and reporting. So our goals are to assist our teaching staff and our administrators with the grant research, identifying funding sources that are aligned, helping with the proposal design process and development, and any editing, writing, and technical assistance that our staff would need. And in that process, we want to try to provide quality assurance to ensure that we're accurately and effectively presenting grant proposals to prospective funding agencies. You know, funding agencies have a myriad of charitable interests, dropout prevention, increasing high school graduation rates, urban schools, disadvantaged students, low-income students. So we try to make sure that what we're looking for is aligned with what our funders' charitable interests are. Okay. So the current grants development process is obviously here, as you can see, is a continuous process where we're identifying sources, like I said, matching charitable interests in the education sector, then the continuous cultivation in our grants and fundraising work, making connections with program officers early on and throughout implementation of our grants. That might include site visits, and it applies to public and private grant makers. Sometimes people think that the public grant makers, you know, aren't as, you know, they sit behind a desk and don't really care about these things, but they do. So we want to make sure that we're cultivating those relationships on a continuous basis. And then solicitation, we have to make certain that we're articulating compelling and persuasive narratives in our writing, and making certain that we're meeting the needs of the students in our district. And then finally, there's the stewardship, our fiduciary responsibility to our grant makers, making sure that those are upheld. That's reporting on the use of funds and project outcomes, and making certain that we are meeting their performance measurement standards. Okay. So for FY 2016, I'm giving you that information. We're just halfway through 2017. So 2016, and really the past several years, we've averaged about $20 million in total grant dollars for the district. Usually it's a little bit over 60% of those are our entitlement dollars. And those are our dollars, previously it was No Child Left Behind, now it's the Every Student Succeeds Act. So we had about $11.9 million in entitlement grants. And for FY16, we were at $1,369,287 is the total of that left side of the pie. And we've done pretty well for FY17. We're already up to $1,552,218 for FY17. As of today, and we'll see how we are at the end of the year in June. Okay, so you can see it's a conglomeration of our private donors, our state. And our federal dollars from the U.S. Department of Education, largely. There are other U.S. Federal sources that we do tap into, but the U.S. Department of Education is the primary source. Okay. And then this slide tells us basically what we the intent here was to articulate that we have our in the red bars our entitlement grants, and then we're constantly trying to stay ahead because of you can see the trend of our entitlement grants has stayed fairly flat. I think we had about a 3% increase this year. It has risen, like I said, very, very slowly. So we continuously try to source out and pursue our private or competitive dollars to stay ahead of that, and we're right about $9.6 million over the last 5 years. Okay, and then this current year, I mentioned earlier, the $1.5 million thus far. So we still have the other half of the year to go. So hopefully we'll bring that number up. Okay, oh, that didn't come out very well. Okay, I'll go back to it. I'll show you what it's supposed to say. This happens. I don't know why this happens to this slide. I teach a class in grant writing, and this happens to me so much. But anyway, this slide is from Giving USA, which is... delineates charitable giving in the U.S. In 2015, that was the latest figures available, and you can see we had $338 billion in charitable giving. So we are still a charitable country. Individuals is the blue slice, and so we are generous individuals. So about 72% of that $338 billion or $258 billion was given by individuals. And that's a large part due to the fact that we typically are very generous to our religious interests. The brownish-orange slice is foundation giving, and that's about 15% of giving. That's corporate and private foundations. The green slice is corporate giving, and that's $17.92 billion. And then the other slice is bequests. The purple slice is bequests. Are what we give in our wills and estates, and that's $28.67 billion. And I was sharing with Kathy this morning, that there's tremendous potential in charitable giving that we are starting to tap into now that we have our alumni relations coordinator. We'll be able to hopefully get out an annual giving campaign to our alumni and also asking them to remember us in their wills. So it's a very significant untapped resource that we are starting to now pursue. Okay, so our objectives, there's basically three objectives I'll outline for you. And of course, one we talked about already briefly, which is pursuing competitive discretionary grants. And that's working collaboratively with district and administrators and teaching staff to research, identify, and prepare those proposals. And the other one is corporate and foundation partnerships and cultivating those. That's cultivating that slice of the pie that we talked about earlier. And the Brockton Education Foundation is a way to solicit that. They're our 501c3, our charitable organization that was created several years ago so that we could pursue funders that require that tax-exempt designation. So that's why the BEF is, and it's of course, we all know that the BEF has been a steward for funds that are donated to the school district. And then there is our, then the BEF strategic, you know, our plan for the school district, developing a case statement for that pursuit of those dollars. We also believe our school committee is another resource that we can tap into in terms of contacts and being able helping us to identify funding sources. Okay. And our second objective is communicating the resources and technical assistance that are offered by our grants office. We've offered, over the past several years, grant writing workshops for teachers and administrators. We had a workshop on October 17th and plan to have another one in the spring. And those are usually, we usually always have to break it down because of the demand for the workshops. We're so happy that there is passion and interest for generating new dollars for the school district among our staff. We've always had to kind of add additional sessions so that we can accommodate everybody. And then our building level support, supporting our staff where the needs are known most greatly, and providing them with guidance and technical assistance in research and grants and proposal development and submission. And I'll mention one of those efforts was recently fruitful. We pursued a grant that's on your agenda, actually, for the Mass Clean Energy Center Activity Day grant, and that was awarded to the George School. And so we'll have a on March 17th, we'll have a Clean Energy Day. They've already previously had an Energy Expo Day. So through the Mass CEC, we will be able to build and enhance upon that work that those teachers are doing. Okay. And our third objective, of course, we talked about promoting awareness, and the post regular updates to our grants office webpage, making certain that that's maintained. Distributing grant opportunities to those relevant areas, if it's a STEM grant, then to our math and science coordinators, relevant education articles and white papers. We have a grant database that needs to be maintained and updated, you know, otherwise it's a dynamic resource that we need to maintain. And then something that's I spoke to Aldo about recently is doing a grants needs assessment for our district. That's something that we plan to do. And of course, with our ongoing technical assistance and support for the grant managers on our grants accounting system, along with our accountants in our finance office, making certain that we're doing accurate budget amendments and final reports, and those things are reconciled properly. And then providing ongoing assistance. We have the State Department of Education as an online payment and financial reporting system. So we have to make certain the folks are understanding how to use that. They have a new Ed Grant system. And then the U.S. Department of Education has what they call a system of award management. And that's so we wanted to make sure that everyone's prepared and understands how to use those systems to the best that they can. And then finally, there's we want to just give you a little bit in terms of what's coming. We just spoke about the Sprint 1 Million project, and that is providing over the next 5 years 500 mobile devices, and those mobile devices include mobile phones and tablets, and then 4 years especially for freshmen, 4 years of internet access for low-income Brockton High School students to close the homework gap. And so this, I think, is a prime example of our corporate neighbors wanting to give back and wanting to make a real, very, very meaningful contribution to public education. And we actually will have our Sprint Activation Fair on, I have my notes here, on January 23rd, coming up, and that'll be led by Mr. Kevin DuPont, our Director of Business and Technical Education here at the high school. And what the plan is for each Brockton High School house will be assigned 125 devices, and they will select students with preference given to 9th and 10th graders, those with, of course, with good attendance and academic progress, no code of conduct violations, and no cell phone activity on the server. So that's how those, that's how that will be deployed. And you know, we're very hoping for a very successful deployment, and very excited about this project. And then coming up, there is the U.S. Department of Education's Innovation and Education Innovation and Research Grant, which is a $2.9 million potentially 3-year grant. And we hope to use that, those funds, if they're awarded, to launch, working with Sharon Wolder and Robert Perkins, a STEM Aviation Academy, which would be an outgrowth of the last 2 years STEM Aviation Summer Camp that's been held here at the high school. So that's I just was worked very, very hard with them this past summer, understanding that program and writing an initial investing in innovation grant, which we did not receive, but we scored very highly, so we believe we will be able to pursue this very competitively, this new, basically it's a revamping of the I-3 grant. So that's so we'll be pursuing that in the spring. And then the Corporation for National Community Service, through the Massachusetts Service Alliance, has an AmeriCorps grant, and through that we hope to, over the next, for 3 years, deploy between 20 and 50 AmeriCorps volunteers across the district. And that's to help in the classrooms, and they're direct service volunteers, and so we hope 20 to 50 full-time AmeriCorps volunteers will be with us to work with our staff, our teaching staff and administrators, to help us to support teaching and learning across the district. And then the Innovative Approaches to Literacy Grant, I was really thrilled to hear previously under No Child Left Behind we were not eligible for this grant, but I just received word that we will be eligible for this grant coming up in 2018/19 to provide 2 years of improving literacy skills, and that's birth to grade 12. I know something was missing on that slide. So these are some grants that are coming down the pike. They're a sample of the grants. I just try to pick out some highlights of what's coming down the pike for us. And that's it. And I appreciate your time. If you have any questions, more questions about the Sprint project or anything else?
I have a question.
Yes.
Thank you for your presentation.
Thank you.
The AmeriCorps grant. I work in a school with 3 AmeriCorps programs. So I was wondering if we knew what programs we were looking at implementing in the BPS.
Well, a priority has been, we don't know. We don't know. We are in the planning stages right now. We have a meeting in a couple of weeks, as a matter of fact, February 1st, to kind of have some of our key department heads, help, led by Mrs. Berry, to identify what the top focus areas will be in terms of implementing that grant.
Okay, great. I'm excited to hear that. They do some really good work.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I'm always impressed by the whole AmeriCorps process. Is always tremendous.
It's quite the machine.
Yeah, yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
Do the students know right now that they can apply for that?
They do. I believe the word has been, yes.
The word is already out?
The word's already out. The word is already out, and because, like I said, the activation fair is coming up, what is it, a week from? The 23rd is a week from, so a week from Monday.
30th?
It's changed to January 30th? Oh, they did change it. Oh, okay. So, thank you. Yeah. So I know that the school's in the process of accepting applications from those students that meet the criteria and are eligible for the program.
Do you have an idea of how much money that actually is? Or a ballpark figure?
I have not calculated the number. That's a good question, though. I know that the phones or the Moto E's, I'm not sure what the retail value of those is. And I do know that they are deploying new devices to us. Yeah. I forgot the name of the tablet, but I do know they're new devices. So it's a tremendous program.
Yeah. And they'll continue to update.
Fabulous.
Right, and what they've done is they're also giving us a 10% additional inventory of the devices just for loss and breakage. Yeah, so basically we get 550 devices.
Nice program. That is beautiful. Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. Thank you.
Anyone else? A couple of things. First, thank you for everything you and your office does. Obviously, from the slide we saw tonight, you know, you're bringing in a lot of money that's making an impact. Couple questions. One, this couple of slides that showed some of how much has been brought in from the grant writing, can we get those sent to us?
What was that?
The slides you had that showed.
Oh, the presentation?
Yeah.
Oh, sure. Yeah, we can.
Because I get questions sometimes about, you know, they're hiring these grant writers and how much are they bringing in, and that pretty much tells the story right there.
Oh, yeah.
So that would be really helpful.
Oh, sure.
You know, if I can have, we could have that information for when we get those kinds
sure,
of questions.
Sure, we can get copies of it.
In your packet.
Excellent.
I don't know if you want an electronic copy or hard copy, however you want it.
Electronic's fine, yeah.
Okay,
you
all
know,
right.
Just so that we have it as reference, because I, like I said, I do get questions about that sometimes, so it would be great to have that to be able to say, here it is.
Okay, sure.
You know?
No problem.
And also this, you know, we've talked about the Sprint program a bit. Mm-hmm. And as you and other organizations have been generous to us, I just wanted to make the point that I hope people will, you know, when they see that, also reward, you know, Sprint for their generosity. Because I think when a business steps up like that and makes a big commitment to us, that, you know, we should, you know, reward them as well with doing business with them. So.
Absolutely, yes. I'm hoping that, you know, one of their representatives is supposed to attend the activation fair, so I hope he can make the new date. We'll hopefully be able to.
The mayor and I have met with the corporation administrators.
Mm. Okay.
We're very excited about coming here. I'm sure we'll put something together.
Yeah.
We want to make sure we're able to highlight and thank them for their support. It makes such a difference when businesses, corporations are able to support the work that we're doing here.
Exactly.
Yeah, great.
The other thing I want to bring to your attention and in the audience, so when you talk about Karen, and she talks to you about supporting teachers, doing workshops, you know, you can't do it alone. And by sharing, you know, her talents or making sure, and we're seeing a whole new generation of teachers that are on the internet, are looking and researching ways and grants that support their departments or their passions. You recently saw the teacher from the Davis School with Danny Amendola. I mean, you were talking about looking at his foundation, putting in a request for this particular, I don't know if you call it a grant, but foundation money. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we were able to go there, Brett and myself, there might have been a couple of others, when he actually came to Brockton. And although that was exciting, it was exciting to see what that grant brought to us. You know, all kinds of books and a reading corner set up. I think it's going to be replicated at the Barrett Russell School.
Oh, great.
So we have a coordinator of foreign languages at Brockton High School, Rachel Umbriana, in the audience, and she and one of her Chinese language teachers at Brockton High put together a grant. It's the Confucius Institute at the University of Massachusetts. Mm-hmm. I think it's enclosure 5 in your packet. And this, again, Brockton High School and Cambridge, Ringe, and Latin were the only two schools selected to receive $10,000 per year for 5 years. That's $50,000. So, again, these types of things really do make a difference, and it's the collaboration between our grants office, our teachers that are out there. You know, every dollar really counts. So I want to thank her, and that hard work. We're excited about that coming into Brockton High School.
Absolutely.
I'd just like to compliment Mrs. Watts on her presentation. Very, very good, very informative. The committee should get to know Karen because she's extremely approachable. She has that very pleasant Midwestern demeanor. You know, if you hear of any opportunities, I'm sure she's very open to listen because, I mean, not everyone can be aware of everything that's out there. And she's, you know, very thorough. So you will learn that very quickly after you have a discussion with her. And she is very good at telling you where we are at in terms of obviously monies that are being taken in and you know, sources that you know, only she and people in her field would know about. But thank you very much, Karen, and we appreciate what you do, and we certainly appreciate your presentation. It was very good, very good. And I'm sorry that you're now spreading your cold to me. I don't know what happened, because I was fine the beginning of the night, and then all of a sudden now, you know, 10 minutes maybe to go or whatever, and I'm falling apart. I think it's either you or Mrs. Sullivan, because she's been hacking all night. So, yeah, there you go. So.
Well, I like that you bring up the fact of Midwestern hospitality, because when I first met Karen...
And sensibility.
Absolutely. Yeah. But when she first came to the district, we had lunch one day. She probably won't remember this. This is my craziness about sports. And I remember saying to her, I never understood in St. Louis when the Red Sox won, why St. Louis and the community were so nice. I never understood that. I do now. So she is just that. I do want to bring up before we close Dr. Cancel once again, not about policies, but I would like him to talk to you a little bit about WIDA access testing happening in the district. You heard me mention 900 students at Brockton High School. This is going on throughout the district. We have some online testing going on, which really was a first time this year. And I told him there were a couple of problems. I think things have smoothed out, but I wanted him to bring this to your attention in case you're getting any phone calls on this.
Right. The best thing, now I'm standing between you and the end of the meeting, so I will be brief. There were some issues. We did some online testing with WIDA Access this year. The schools that participated, Huntington, Hancock, Raymond, Downey, South, and Ashfield. On January 10th and 11th, there was a statewide issue with the WIDA testing. It only affected 50 students in the Brockton Public Schools. So that's important to realize the scope of it. It wasn't a disaster. It was statewide, but at that moment, the way WIDA is given, there were only 50 students who were affected. In the afternoon, they were able to go back online. Nothing was lost, so it's not as if they had lost all their previous work. It is obviously not an ideal testing setup when that occurs, but this does happen from time to time with online testing. As the platforms become more mature, more stable, this sort of hiccup will be reduced. However, I say that looking at it from a global perspective. If it was your child, if it was your student, you would be very distraught because, you know, you're in the midst of testing, the next thing you know, you can't test. Not your fault, no one's fault, but those are hardly the perfect conditions. The state is aware of it. The state is looking into what they can do because, as I said, it affected all the districts, not just Brockton. And hopefully they will make appropriate adjustments to the scoring. They should be able to see exactly who the students were who were testing at that time. And there were 2 days, as I said, and it was both in the mornings. It was okay by the afternoon. So that is the news. The good news is, except for that hiccup, things seem to be going very smoothly. This is the first year that we are doing online testing, not in all of our schools, but in those schools that I mentioned. So any questions? I feel a lot more comfortable with this than the policy stuff.
Right. What should they say? We appreciate what you do, Ethan. Thank you. Anything else, Madam Superintendent? Okay, well, let me get back to our agenda. Okay, any unfinished business or, I'm sorry, any items to refer to subcommittee at this point? No? Okay. Any unfinished business? Okay. New business. Okay. Report of the January 17, 2017 Facilities Subcommittee meeting. Action requested. The subcommittee met this evening at 5:45. The members present were Mrs. Azak and Mr. Sullivan. We met with Mr. Thomas and Mr. Petronio. At that meeting, we discussed a couple of issues. One was the lease of the warehouse space. The lease is getting close to being expired, and we also discussed at that meeting a proposal to purchase a generator for the school system, a portable generator, actually. With regard to the warehouse, we discussed putting out a bid through procurement for three additional years, subject to a one-year option to opt out if, in fact, we found a space that we could afford to purchase. We also, at that meeting, with regard to the warehouse, decided to do a little due diligence and are going to approach the city with respect to trying to locate a building that perhaps we could purchase if it's the right set of circumstances financially, and eliminate the need to lease warehouse space. Basically, you know, owning is certainly better than leasing. So at that meeting, there was a vote to move those items forward, and that is, I believe, the gist of our facilities subcommittee meeting. If I'm correct, could someone that was at that meeting make a motion to accept the minutes of the facilities subcommittee meeting of this evening?
Motion to accept the minutes of the subcommittee meeting tonight.
And we would need a second.
Second.
Okay, any further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? None opposed. Okay. With respect to those minutes, I believe we need to ratify the recommendation of the subcommittee, the facilities subcommittee, and that would be for the first item, a motion to extend our procurement of a lease for 3 years with the one-year option to opt out, and also to seek a proposal to purchase an available warehouse if the right financial set of circumstances appear or come to fruition. Can I get a motion to recommend that recommendation?
So moved.
I need a second. Okay, any further discussion? Would any of the committee like to discuss any of anything with regard to that motion? Okay, seeing no one wanting to discuss it any further, all in favor? Any against? Okay, and then the second item would be to approve the recommendation to go forward to the City Council with the procurement of a portable generator, which, do you want to say something about that? Or I thought you looked like you wanted to say something.
No.
Oh, okay, all right, great. Apparently the school system, it's uncertain in certain circumstances, bad weather, outages, what have you. We could actually lose, you know, a day or two of school in certain places, and sometimes, obviously, we lose our heating systems and we have a lot of electrical. So Mr. Petronio and Mr. Thomas believe that the obtainment of a portable generator so that it could be brought to different sites in case, you know, instead of it being a fixture at one site, it could be used at Central, it could be used over at the Arnone, et cetera, any school, basically. So they feel that that's a priority, and there was a recommendation to approach the City Council because it is a large expenditure. Costs around $52,000. We would need to, because it's sort of a capital improvement type of a expenditure, request of the City Council permission to move forward with such a purchase. So, so that being said, can I have a motion to move forward to the City Council with the request to move to purchase a portable generator? Okay, Mr. Gormley, you go first. You beat Mr. Sullivan to the punch.
Motion to approve the recommendation to purchase.
Okay.
A generator.
Mr. Sullivan, are you going to second that?
Second.
All right. Any further discussion? Seeing none. Enough being said on this. All in favor? None opposed. Okay. With respect to the second item, report of the January 17th policy subcommittee meeting. As we all know on the committee, this is a subcommittee of the whole, so everyone was present who is here. Dr. Cancel, Superintendent Smith, reviewed some of the policies that affect the school committee, and we pointed out some issues or some items that we'd like to remain in place. We would like a little more time to review certain parts of the different policies. So the school committee basically is going to, through the superintendent, continue that discussion and pick another date to for further review, basically. It was a good discussion. Certain items were brought forward. Ms. Plant certainly brought a couple of items to our attention, and we appreciate that. And I think that basically is the gist. We did vote on one item in there to not change the policy with regard to visitation of schools. So that was that old policy is still in place rather than any recommended changes to that. So. I believe that's basically what we did at that meeting. Can I have a motion to approve the minutes of the policy review subcommittee? Okay, second?
Second.
All right, any further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? Great, and then I think we just need to approve that final piece about keeping intact the current policy with respect to school visitations. Can I get a motion on that?
Motion to the policy on school visitations, unamended.
Ethan, do you remember which number?
BCA.
BCA is our cable station.
BHC, I believe.
Which one?
BHC? Yes.
BAC?
BHC.
Thank you, Lisa. I appreciate it. Okay. So to keep intact policy BHC with regard to school visitations. I'm sorry. Can someone make that motion?
Motion.
All right. Second that. All right. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? Wonderful. Okay. Anything else under new business that someone would like to bring up? Mr. Gormley.
There are a few athletic things around the city that I'd like to bring to the attention of the public. Brockton Youth Baseball is a new Little League organization that was formed. Southwest Little League and Brookfield have merged to form one Little League. The Downey is still operating on their own, I believe, so that leaves us with two Little Leagues in the city. There will be a parent meeting itself on February 1st at 6:45 at the Brookfield on March 1st at 6:45 also. You can register online, and you can also register at South Middle School February 8th and 15th, March 8th and 15th as well. And online registration begins on the 25th. So I thought people should be made aware of that. That's a change for us in the youth sports community. And there's another new league that's a new sport. About, I think, a month ago, Mr. Fidalgo from Brockton High and the Brockton High track program brought us a great presentation about a donation that was made. He also mentioned that we have a youth track program. That has opened registration as well at brocktonyouthtrack.com. We'll have more information on in-person registration. I'd like to thank Mr. Thomas for helping us out and getting the track time. I'm involved in that. Track's one of my sports that I really love. And also, last week, Mr. Cairo, the athletic director, made a presentation to Save Our Sports. And we're going to be getting a new strength and conditioning center. Our weight room was installed when I was in high school in 1996. It's gotten a little old. There's been some updates, but things have changed with regard to how we train our athletes, and we've kind of fallen behind. And I know that in the past, some folks have tried to do different things, and Mr. Cairo came up with a great solution. Save Our Sports contributed most of the funds for this. The school department contributed about, I'd say, a quarter of the funds. And it'll be a great thing for our athletes and our students, because our students will get to use it for physical education class as well, and intramurals. So that's all I have.
Good. What are the ages on your Brockton youth baseball?
Youth baseball is, it goes from T-ball to Babe Ruth, so it's ages 4 to 16, and that's roughly what track will be as well. Track will be 5 to 14. And I'm very excited about the track program. We've never had a youth track program. And it's been a hugely successful sport up at the high school. And amazingly, there's no training and there's no exposure for kids to run and throw and outside of the competitions that we'll have once a year within our schools.
With respect to sports, I'd like to compliment Mr. Kenny as well as Mrs. Bradshaw of Spectrum Gymnastics. The gymnastics program at Brockton, in the Brockton Public Schools, Brockton High in particular, is now in the process of being rebuilt, basically. And the both of them are working very diligently and putting in a lot of time with the girls' gymnastics team, and you can see that the participants are very excited. And I went to a couple of the competitions and totally blown away, certainly at the ability of these young ladies. And you can see the excitement in the Brockton team. They are, you know, getting better every meet. They are definitely on the upswing. There are teams that have been in place for quite some time that are just, you know, off the charts, but our young ladies are doing a great job, and Mr. Kenny and Ms. Bradshaw are seeing improvement and very happy with what's going on with this team this year, and they anticipate next year and each year the program getting stronger. So without their participation and without their efforts, there wouldn't be a program, and they're really giving it. Boy, I'm losing my voice tonight. Giving it their all, and it's just a great thing to watch. My compliments to the ladies as well. The young ladies participating.
Is that in collaboration with Cardinal Spelman?
Oh yeah. Why don't you mention that?
Well, I just think, as you said, I think we're trying to rebuild. I know they were struggling. We petitioned the MIAA, and we're given permission to work, you know, with the high school within our city to allow more girls to participate and to compete together, so you would actually have a competitive team. It'll probably take a few years to really rebuild, and hopefully Brockton will be able to have their own program, and as will Cardinal Spelman as we go forward.
Anyone else have anything to report in, whether it's sports or something else? No? Okay. I do not believe we need to go into executive session, correct?
Correct.
All right.
Correct.
Can I, seeing no further business, can I entertain a motion to adjourn? Second? All in favor? Great. Thank you. Adjourned.